Hello. Today we're going to model circuits, very simple circuits, using Kirchhoff's law. Now Kirchhoff's law says that the algebraic sum of voltage drops across the elements in a simple loop of an electrical circuit is equal to the applied voltage. So what we're going to use today is going to be a resistor and a capacitor and some energy source, E of t. So what this says is that I'm going to have the amount of energy, or the voltage drop for the resistor, plus the voltage drop for the capacitor is going to be equal to E of t. And we're actually going to do an actual experiment, and we're going to verify this actually does work. Now, according to Ohm, we know that the voltage drop for a resistor is going to be proportional to the current. So that's going to be some R value times I. Now, I use R because, of course, the R is called the resistance. Now, I is also, we can also write I in terms of, let's see, the rate of change of the capacitor. So this is really going to be R times dQ dt, where Q represents the change in the capacitor. The voltage drop for the capacitor is going to be 1 over C times Q. So what we see for our formula is the following. Let's get this out of the way. I'll move this to the side somewhere. Is the following formula. I see I'm going to have R times dQ dt. This is from the resistor that I have over there, plus 1 over C times Q is equal to E of t. Now this is a very important formula that I'm going to want to remember for a while, so I'll box this into red. So instead of actually solving this first and then getting equations, let's actually just do the experiment and watch this happen. So I'm going to sort of move all this out of the way, Kirchhoff's law here, and I'm going to actually record it, an experiment that I did, and we can actually see this work. Now you see the circuit there, and I'll actually describe the components. They're actually over here, the ones I actually have, but you'll see that the voltage is 9 because it's a 9-volt battery. As soon as I remove the battery, you'll see that the volts start going down. And what I'm doing now is I'm recording the data. So I'm recording the discharge from the capacitor. And the question is, what is the shape of this curve? Is it going to be a parabola? Is it going to decay exponentially? What's actually happening? So here I am collecting the data as it moves down. And it was only 20 seconds worth of data. And you'll see we get this curve here. And you'll also notice that the initial spot was 6.17. So I'll use this as my initial condition. So I'll have to remember that for the time being. Okay, so I'll put this over here. And let's talk about the components of that particular circuit. So the first one is, I'll talk about this resistor. So this was the resistor that was used in the experiment. The first one, the brown, indicates a 1, the black indicates a 0, the gold indicates 10,000, which you multiply it through by, so it's 10 times 10,000, which gives us 100,000 ohm, and the gold band there represents 5% tolerance level. So this is, in other words, a 100 kOhm, kiloohm, or you just say 100,000 ohm resistor. Alright, so that is the resistor that we were using, and then you'll also notice that we had a capacitor. Now the capacitor is a little bit easier to read. You'll notice that it says right there off the bat, it's 220 microfarad. It's named after Faraday, and it can hold within 35 volts. Okay, so I'm gonna have to actually convert this over to farads so that the units will match up in Kirchhoff's law. So let's go ahead and do that now. Let's see, 220 microfarads is going to be, well, 1 microfarad is the same as 10 to the negative 6 farads. So if you multiply that out, you're going to get 2.2 times 10 to the negative 4 farads. So we have to make sure that all the units match ohms and farads and whatnot in order to use the equation. So let's shrink everything so I can have a little bit of space to solve this difference equation. Now the cool thing is this difference equation is going to be something that you can even solve in Calc 1. So I'll push that over to the side. Now remember, this is the formula that we have here. Right? I'm going to use R and C. I'll keep it in that way. The first thing we'll notice is that the initial condition, Q of 0, remember, that was equal to 6.17. That was from the video. Volts. And we also know that E of t was equal to 0 because, remember, the battery wasn't hooked up to it when I took the reading. So we have a very simple first-order differential equation. Let me just write that down. We just have R dQ dt. Remember, Q is that's the charge of the capacitor, plus 1 over C times Q is equal to 0. If I divide everything through by R and bring stuff to the other side, I'm going to get dQ dt is equal to negative 1 over CR times Q. Now, of course, this is just a separation of variables. You can have 1 over Q dQ is equal to negative 1 over CR dt. All right, now, again, if I just integrate both sides, you're going to have the natural log of the absolute value of Q is equal to negative 1 over CRT plus some constant. And just to make sure it's a different constant than my C, I'm just going to have, I'll call this C1 or C star, something to that effect. Now, let's shrink that just a little bit so we can have some more space off to the side. I'll keep going. So that means that I'm going to have Q of T is equal to E to the negative 1 over CR T plus my C1, but that's really just my initial condition. So C of T plus, I'll call this C0 E to the negative 1 over CR times T. So this is my initial condition, and remember our initial condition was 6.17 volts. So if I write that down, I'm going to have Q of T, this is my final, is going to be 6.17 times E to the negative, and remember my capacitor was 100,000, and this was 2.2 times 10 to the 4, so that's just going to simplify down to 1 over 22 times T. So this is my mathematical model. Now let's see how this actually compares to the real part. So I type this into the calculator, and we'll see how this looks. So there, as you see, I typed it into the calculator, and we're going to actually graph it at the same time, and we'll see how this compares. So here we have it. Now you'll see that it's pretty close. My hand's a little shaky. I'm actually holding the calculator. But you see actually how close it is to that. That's remarkably close. It's pretty close. You can barely see the difference between the line. And all we did was just use a model. So this model actually works out fairly nicely. And that's the introduction to very simple little circuits using Kirchhoff's law. Now obviously we can do a little bit more interesting things if we allow the energy source to fluctuate or if we allowed for inductors. But we'll just go ahead and leave it at that for right now. Thank you.